And welcome back to Let's Interactively Play Steve Jackson's Sorcery, the Let's Play where you get to make a choice at the end of the video and determine what we will do next. Speaking of which, the majority vote this time was Fireview Square. No one wanted to go to the Road to the Gate. Oh, no one wanted to go to Upper Kharé. Sorry, one person did want to go to the Road to the Gate, and I really do want to check out some of the other tombs here, especially that one that we've uncovered, one of the, you know, stewards or masters of the city. I never did check out his tomb, but we might have a chance to go there after Fireview Square. We do want to check out the Fallen Quarter as well. Halls of Vlada, I don't think we've been in. We haven't been to Upper Kharé, so... Now this takes us back in time, in which case we're going to lose our items, I'm thinking. I hope not. Because, what do we have? We found this tinderbox underneath the city. I don't know. I want to go back and get all this stuff again. A tinderbox. Bracelet of Bone. I think that's all we have. Tumblers 2 sealed deep inside. Kharé Gate Key. Yeah. Given by the Svin Chief. Alright. That's to get in the city. At this point we want to work our way out of the city. So let's see if we have these items when we go back. Probably not. You are being wrenched in directions you did not know existed. The pain is unbearable, and just when you think you will go mad from it, the forces tear you apart. Your struggle to grab onto your belongings and your very self as you tumble down from the clouds. And then you are awake, your eyes open once more. Your surroundings have changed. You are back on the approach to Fireview Square. Once again, you stand in the plaza of the Red Eyes, the heart of this half of the city port. In all directions, road lead off, some no doubt to the houses of nobles, and others directly into danger. On the other side of the square, the main road continues on through a low arch. A thousand other alleyways lead off in all directions into Upper Kharé. Again, all the same stuff. Let's see. I get to... my items. Still have the tinderbox. We still have the bracelet of bone. Nice. So we still have our items. That's freaking awesome. Of course our weapons haven't changed since the beginning of the game, just this plain sword. Hopefully at some point we'll get a better one. And all these clues. Okay, so that's awesome. I'm pretty happy about that. I've read all this already. I'm not gonna read again. Look through the arch. I don't have any... look at the alleyways. I don't have any money still. So we've talked to this guy already, I'm just going to go through. Yep. I don't think there's anything new with that. What is this monument? You ask one of the creatures. Can't you tell? The creature replies. Were you born yesterday? Suggest an idea. You rack your brains for something that could explain it. It's a trap. The creature nods. You're right, stranger. Several red eyes have disappeared into it, including myself earlier. We're waiting to see if anything comes out. And if it does... He opens his eyes for a moment, and you catch a glimpse of burning red fire in the sockets of his skull. Then his eyelids close once more. The crowd are clustered around the monument as though expecting the rug inside to move. Well, I'm not going into it this time. That was a pain in the butt. You step away, shaking your head. You can make no sense of it. Well, don't we remember this? From around the monument, you hear a sudden gasp. Something has happened. Now, we have our items from before. When we initially looked around the square, we, you know, looked at it as if we were looking at it for the second time. But now we don't remember about this monument and falling down. Look back at the monument. You cast another look at the monument and the crowd around it, but nothing seems to have changed. The creatures are still waiting for something. You look around the various exits from the square. Okay, so... An alley. Through the arch. Let's go through the arch. You walk between the narrow buildings until you reach a fork. To the left, the road continues towards some kind of bustling market, while to the right, it leads down a shorter street. In the center of the fork is a great bronze statue with some kind of pot at its feet, with a strategically placed club down the short street. Looking down the short street to the right, you see a sign above a doorway reading, "The Gambling Halls of Lada." This is the wrong place for me to be. I have absolutely no money. Several seedy-looking creatures mill about on the steps. Cheerful creatures go in, and miserable-looking ones come out. The statue is of a giant brute wielding a club, and at its feet is a large pot filled with gold pieces. This must be one of Kharé's many gods, and the pot is intended for worshippers making offerings, although none of the passing creatures seem to be throwing any in. Well, yeah, they've gambled away all their money. Time to move on. Let's just look at the statue. You go over to the statue and look into the pot. It seems to contain almost 20 gold pieces. Oh my god. I might do it, guys. Look up at the statue. Tilting your head, you look upwards at the statue. He is an imposing figure, at least four times your height, and solidly armed. You do not recognize the god depicted, but his presence so close to the gambling hall suggests he is either a god of prosperity or a god devoted to punishing those who do not pay their debts. Now, I notice our god has changed back from the one we, you know, got last time. So I don't want to pay... I want to go back and, you know, pay that god a visit again. I forget the name. It's a god of generosity or something like that. Charity. And now, so at least with the baboon, I avoid pissing off that god because... So what happens if we take the gold? Well, my god might change. This statue might come alive and fight us. We might get attacked by the guards. I really need it, guys. Normally I would not do this. But hey. I need it more than this statue does. Take the gold. You reach down and scoop the money from the pot into your pouch. Easy enough. But then a creaking noise makes you freeze. I'm gonna run for it. You turn and run, and just in time, I got 18 gold. The statue behind you has started to move and is on the attack. It smashes down with its club, catching you painfully in the middle of your back. You stagger to your knees, gasping. Picking yourself up quickly, you see the bronze giant has leapt from its pedestal and is advancing towards you. See, I knew, guys. So I can draw my sword and just fight. I can give back the money, which seems like a stupid. We traded that. We lost stamina for nothing then. We can cast a spell. I'm gonna summon a giant. That's what I'm gonna do. Or I'm gonna make myself into a giant. You know what? Summon giant. Let's see if I can do it. I'll trade giant teeth for a... Is it giant teeth? Yeah, giant's tooth for 18 gold. I think that's we need the gold more. So it is Yob. Nice. Boom. You throw down a tooth and cast the spell. The tooth erupts into a plume of smoke and in its place emerges a giant, easily as tall as the bronze statue. The two colossal creatures face each other down and the street clears around them. This will either be a titanic fight or an extremely brief one. Should I run for it? I kind of want to see what happens though. I'm kind of wondering, thinking the giant might lose. Number one, he's a conjured creature, which are typically never as quite as strong as a, you know, the real thing. Number two, the giant is made of flesh, and the statue is made of bronze. But I do want to see what happens. The giant thunders forwards, trying to intimidate the statue, not realizing that the statue is a remorseless mechanical creature that knows no fear. The giant quickly learns, however, as the statue simply waits for it to come close and then swings its massive club in one direction and its gigantic fist in the other. The giant spits blood onto the dust and then brings down its narrow club, tearing a chunk out of a nearby building. You dodge to one side and narrowly avoid the crashing masonry. Shall I watch for one more round? The next round goes in more in the giant's favor. Raising the club up over its head, he brings it down on the statue's crown, placing a deep indentation in its brass cranium. Then it swings sideways, damaging the statue's chest. A jet of hot steam ejects from a panel in the statue's left leg. As the statue stumbles, it drags tiles off a nearby roof, one of which strikes you in the arm. Ow, I lost another stamina. I'm gonna watch again. But the statue is not defeated. Or even slowed. It keeps on coming, battering the giant with remorseless energy. It brings down its club, and the giant, rather than being turned to jelly, disappears in a puff of smoke. The statue turns to bear down on you. You will have to finish the task. Oh, damn it. In the milliseconds available, you scour the creature for scratches, blemishes, anything that might suggest a chink in its armoring. Hold on a second, guys. It does have a deep indentation now in the brass cranium of its head. It swings sideways. A jet of hot steam ejects from the panel on the statue's left leg. Stumbling. Okay, I don't have an option for the head. So... it is the left leg, right? Just making sure. Left leg. You race forward. I'm alive. Good. You race forward towards the creature's left leg and spy a small metal plate. Yes, which steam came out of. Twisting your sword around in your hand, you drive it into the crack and begin to lever the panel open. The giant flails this way and that, trying to shake you loose, but you are determined. And finally, the plate flies open. A blast of hot gas ejects from the statue. It sways and then topples face down into the street. 18 gold. Am I done? There's no further repercussions? That'd be awesome. You gasp with relief and take a moment to recover your breath. You have survived, and a count shows you are 18 gold pieces richer. You have found one new clue. Hey, we can go back to the bowl. You said there was 20 in there. Oh, can't go back to the bowl. I got another clue now. Sweet. The Statue of Matak. bronze statue outside the halls of Lada has an access panel on its left leg. Well, that's nice. You destroyed it now. So let's get a better view. One or two of you said we want to make sure we go to the Fallen Quarter. So I don't want to head this way or that way. That will lead away. And this is just back to the square. I have gold now. Should I bother? Yeah, that would be stupid after going without gold for so long. But let me just check out the Halls of Flatta. You enter the shade of a long hall, filled with bodies and smoke, but strangely silent. No one is speaking, and the only noise is the constant rattling of dice, which rolls around the raftered ceiling like thunder. Only the occasional cheer and curse breaks the mood. By the door is a booth, and the gaming tables are out in the main hall. A great cheer goes up from one of the tables. Anything else? The booth. You go over to the booth where a Sfin lady is handing out gambling chips. She smiles at you. Welcome, good lady. She croons in a voice which sounds like a crocodile pretending to be a songbird. How much can I get you? What's the game? You ask. The lady laughs at you. What else? She replies. Swindle stones. Do you know how to play? Yeah, kids. How much should I take? You ask. I'm new here. Oh, she purrs. We love new players at the Halls of Lada. You give us all of your gold. No real money is allowed on the premises. Then, when you leave, we give you what you've still got. I mean, what you've won. It's very simple. No, I'm not giving you all my gold. I don't fancy the odds, you tell her. She shrugs. Neither would I. You head for the door. All right, so we don't have the option to go to the tables now. I really don't want to play Swindle Stones, and I want to keep my gold. Sorry, guys. Hope you aren't too disappointed. You head up the road towards the giant statue once more. The statue lies face down in the street. A few locals are now sitting on the back of the statue, eating their lunch. No one really cares. The day is drawing on. This road doesn't lead unless we manage to get in here and head across all this crap to get to the Fallen Quarter. And this goes up towards the Red Quarter, which is Upper Kharé, which is one of the places we have to go, so I don't know. Halls of Lada. Go back to the square and see if there's any options open then. Oh, here. There's an alley this way. You choose a random alleyway on the right side of the square and slip into the shadow between the tall buildings. The houses either side are well-built and well-defended. There are iron railings on the windows, and some even have arrow slits and portcullises. One housekeeper has dug a moat across his front door. A moat. Outside one building, a tall man stands with a grappling hook. Let's watch him. You hang back and watch as he swings his grappling hook twice, aiming for one of the windows on the floor above. The hook misses and clatters to the street below, and the man curses before gathering up the rope for another try. I just can't resist. Approach him. Sorry, guys. Throat noise. You cautiously approach the man as he swings his hook once more. Greetings. You begin with a respectful nod. The man turns to you. Stranger, he says. I'm in a terrible fix. The man gathers the rope for another swing. He is clearly tiring. What's the problem? I've been locked out. This is my home, and I've lost my key, but I've got a terrible throw, as you can probably see. The man throws again, and misses again. Where did you get the grappling hook? You ask, still suspicious. Would you believe I found it? Near an old well in the wasteland. I was wandering about there, feeling sorry for myself, and I chanced across it. I need directions. Perhaps you can help me. Directions? Why, well, the man looks irritated, but not unhelpful. Certainly. Where do you need to go? The ruins. Which ruins? He cocks his head down the alley. Keep going straight. You're almost there. Though why you'd want to visit them, I can't guess. The man gives up. He winds up the rope around his shoulder, then cups his hands to his mouth. Esme, will you just open the door and let me in? For a moment, nothing happens. Then a bucket of slop is thrown out over the man. He stands, dripping in muck. Who is Esme? You ask from a safe distance away. I married an elven, he explains, sadly. Lovely eyes, but you really can't trust them. He stalks away up the alley. Time for you to move on. That was funny as hell. Yes, she either is very mischievous or does not trust him. Alright, back along the alley. The street is falling into disrepair around you. Something has blighted this region of the city. Even the streets and the gardens behind the mansions have turned black where they stand. The only greenery is the moss on the stone walls. There are no rats scurrying underfoot, and only spiders roost in the rooftops. You pass a particularly grand house, its doors locked with a heavy iron chain. Look at the house. There's a metal S bolted beneath one gable. Perhaps it is the owner's mark. Perhaps it is there to stop the wall falling out onto the street. There's a ringing noise from down the alley. A hooded creature with a bell around its neck is approaching in shuffling steps. I haven't been here, have I? Look at the creature. A long black robe conceals what manner of creature it is, but it walks slowly, as though in great pain. Around its neck is a bell, ringing with every heavy step. Greetings, stranger, you call. The creature with the bell does not look up, but continues its shuffling approach. Now that the creature is close, you can hear its sighing, painful breath. I don't have, a read thoughts or something like that. I mean, obviously I can't help this guy. At least not directly. Hurrying onwards, I'm thinking what brings me back to the map, and I continue down the alley. Opening the door. That's not my house. I notice our deity hadn't changed from the statue. It might change with that. I'm not sure. I'm not sure how honorable the baboon is to begin with. Or cast a spell. I don't have a lot of stamina. Should I cast a spell? Like what? Detect trap. I mean, nothing. I'm not going to cast anything combat oriented. Psychic info for safest escape. Most of these are for combat. And now I'm into the area. Looking at my list of spells here, guys, I wrote down. There's quite a few. Yeah. I mean, I do want to check out the house. But I don't want to just open it. I mean, is it his house? Hurry onwards. You ignore the shuffling creature and leave the empty house behind. A narrow alley opens up to your left, slipping between the buildings. Well, I'm very curious about the house and the man, but it doesn't seem like we can do anything here. Follow the alley, follow the road. Let's follow the road, which heads towards the fallen quarter. The buildings are thinning out through a gap between roofs. You can make out a tall, crooked steeple some way away, like a finger pointing up towards the heavens. A dark shape sits at its very tip. Gargoyle? Look at the shape. As you watch, the shape seems to grow wide, then flatten once more, as though it had opened and closed. A bird, perhaps? Or simply a flag draping downwards in the still air? I do not know. You can only go forward into the wasteland. We're looking for the beggar guy, which, I don't know, maybe it was him? I didn't have an option to interact with him anymore, so we're looking for a blind beggar in any case. Who was one of the lords of Kharé, right? I remember the lords. Once again, you are emerging from the alley into a wide area of wasteland. Once this was a busy city district, but now it looks like as though a hurricane has leveled it. Nothing stands higher than head height. A few staircases lead to nowhere, and in some places a door still stands. Plants grow from every crevice and crack as though someone had poured green paint over the whole scene. Things are constantly moving and shuffling between the leaves. The road, such as it is quickly smothered by piles of wreckage. There are lots of other ways to pick your way through. One possible route leads up and over the side of a broken-down house. Another passes by what might have been once been a mill. You would have to climb over the mill wheel to continue this way. Broken-down house or the mill. Let's look at the broken house. The house has been sliced like a many-layered cake, showing the floors that were once inside. Open rooms have been stripped of their color by the wind and light, and of their possessions by a decade or more of scavengers. But there are still hints that this place was once a family home. The hooks in the ceiling above the hearth, the marks notched on the ground floor pillar that suggest the height of growing children. All right, let's look at the mill. Who would build a mill out here, so far from the river? Still, there is a gigantic mill wheel lying on its side in the path. Despite Despite the state that the building next to it is in, the wheel itself seems perfectly intact and has not even lost its perfect circular shape. I don't know what leads in which direction, so I know we want to go be in the Fallen Quarter somewhere, or near it. Let's step over the mill wheel, as a mill sounds interesting. You clamber up the side of the mill wheel, swing your leg across the side, then suddenly you are falling. What? Not again? Are you freaking serious? You have fallen into a portal trap once more. You brace yourself as you tumble through the air, knowing full well what is coming. In a sewer, again. I'm pretty sure I've been in this exact area as well. Maybe we can just climb this ladder and get back up. Single speck of light somewhere in the far distance. What about the ladder? Oh, crap. Apologize? Fine, take me to they're gonna take all my gold! You bow your head. I apologize. I lost my way. That much is certainly true. He draws a curved blade and sharpens it against one claw. Fine, take me to the king, I guess. You demand. The goblin laughs. Certainly, we will drag your corpse to his feet. Oh, is this? Am I only fighting one goblin? Because there's a lot of them. Certainly, we will drag your corpse to his feet. He gestures behind him, and one of his warriors steps up, grinning and drawing a long, hooked blade. Gonna defend at first. Ah, I should have gone. The goblin races towards you. You steady your footing and bring your sword up to cover your chest. It moves back, quivering with fear. It stares at you nervously. Alright. Thrust. You bring your blade up and intend to sever its chest. Fortuitously, the goblin's weapon takes the worst of the attack. It shows its teeth and hisses. I'm going to defend now. Fearful, you drop back, eyeing the goblin intently. It yelps. You knock it away and it staggers. You steal your focus. The goblin tracks you. I should have gone... no, I wasn't even thinking. You remain on your guard. Goblin also crouches. You eye each other carefully. It growls and hisses. Ha! You force yourself onwards. You have defeated the goblin. One stamina lost. Decent dueling. The goblin leader laughs. He gestures another of his minions to face you. You're freaking kidding me. This one has 8 stamina. The goblin charges forwards through the sewer. You try to gauge his size and swing hard for the creature's chest. It moves away, shaking with terror. The creature growls and spits. Fearful, you duck back into a crouch. The goblin roars and charges for you madly. You beat it away and it tumbles. You ready your gaze on it. The creature tracks you nervously. I didn't even have to use nearly that much. You twist your sword grip and aim to chop its neck. By sheer luck, the goblin's weapon deflects the worst of the impact. The goblin growls and spits. Fearful, you drop back, eyeing the goblin intently. It slices at you with all its might. Its blade flashes. The creature eyes you cautiously. Next, you are leading the fight. You force yourself across the sewer. The goblin turns and runs across the sewer. The goblin watches you fearfully. Not even attacking now. Following it, you charge forward and drive the side of your blade towards its arm. The goblin's weapon deflects the worst of the blow. It follows you. Damn it. Cautious, you duck back, eyeing the goblin intently. It also crouches. You eye each other. It follows your stance carefully. Then you are attacking the goblin. Holding your weight back, you slash across the goblin's skull. It dodges back and runs across the water. The goblin is weakening. Ah, crap. Ouch. Sheek. Then the goblin's on you like a storm, swinging a massive lunge with its sword. You go to shatter its skull, but leave yourself open. You're seriously injured. The goblin eyeballs you nervously. Next, you are seizing the advantage. You catch the creature a slashing slice on the side. By sheer luck, the goblin's weapon catches some of the impact. Fearful, you duck back into a crouch. The goblin tries to land a passing blow, but you see it coming. The goblin eyes you intently. The goblin is almost defeated. Good thing. On instinct, you duck back into a crouch. The goblin roars and goes for you through the sewage. You knock it aside and it staggers into the dirt. You are almost without strength. The creature hoists its sword in the air. Boom! A moment later, you are leading the fight. You alter your weapon hold and intend to chop its neck. You have defeated the goblin. 6 stamina lost. Shameful. The goblin leader frowns. He is starting to get angry. I have 0 stamina. You are feeling breathless and weak and can barely stand. The goblins take advantage of this and rush you in a great number. You cannot escape. Something moves and everything goes black. What's my fate? Death, you have died. I am rewinding and not choosing that path. We are falling into the wasteland. We have the 18 gold. We have our items. Yes, good. Okay. Still gonna just look at these things. Climb the broken house. You clamber up the fallen rubble to the roof of the broken building. From here, you get a clear view across the rest of the wasteland. It stretches for a mile or two and will take about an hour to cross on foot, and at its far side, a tall iron fence thick with ivy slices across your hand. Perhaps to keep the people of the wasteland out, or to keep whatever is beyond the fence in. In the distance, you see dark shapes moving across the sky. Let's eat something. You perch on the collapsed chimney stack and eat the apple. The dark shapes in the distance wheel and turn about around the steeple of some tall building, perhaps once a church. Some kind of bird? It is hard to be sure. Once you are finished, it is time to continue. You make your way down the far side of the building and back onto the path beyond, which soon forks. You know, we probably should have returned to the Fireview Square and see if we can get some more, you know, stuff. Rations. Because we have about half stamina. We have plenty of gold, you know, relatively speaking, from what we had before. And now we have no rations. Right or left? Oh, I'm just gonna choose right because it's closer to the words Fallen Quarter, which is where we're supposed to be, I think. You follow the path to the right, between broken foundations and cracked streets. On one side, a roof sticks half out of the sand dune. On the other, a front door lies flat on the ground, as though leading to a hidden cellar. Then the path comes to a building that, amidst all this destruction, is still standing. Its door is closed, and its stone walls seem completely intact. I'm going to try this door, though. You try the door and find that it falls open at the slightest touch. Alright. I know, it doesn't make sense. We skipped the other building. But, who's the... Hold on a second. That building had an S on it. Lord Theta. Yeah, that's where I want to be. Fallen Quarter. Looking for Lord Theta. Oh, Theta! I just can't just call out for him. Maybe he's in this house. The house consists of a single room with a large table and a large chair, and in the far corner, a sealed box. Everything around seems in good repair. The wood looks waxed and polished, and the hinges on the box are free of dust. I'll look around first. From the doorway, you stop and look around. And that's when you notice the foot sticking out from under the table. Foot. You crouch down and peer at the foot. It is clawed, and a dull shade of gray-green is about the size of your head, and it sticks out from under the low table. This house feels dead. Even the air inside seems not to move. See if the foot moves. Huh. You hang back nervously to see if the foot does anything. It does not move. It does not smell, either. So whoever's foot it is, they are certainly not dead. Sleeping, maybe? I'm gonna leave it here. What do you guys think I should do? Gonna leave this out of the equation. We're either prodding it, which, if the thing is asleep, will probably wake it up. Or we'll go for the box, which, if the thing is awake and observing our actions, will piss it off and make it attack us. So what do you think? This is an odd choice, so I'm interested to see what you guys think. I'm gonna prod the foot or go for the box. Leave your comments below, and we'll see what happens next time. Hopefully next episode we'll find this guy, you know. Hopefully he's not back in the S house, but that was before the Fallen Quarter, right? On the way? We're looking for that lord. What's his name? Beetha or something like that? Theta. Right, so let me know, guys. Prod the foot or go for the box. Thanks so much for watching, and see you guys next week. Endure. In enduring, grow strong.